John, that was great. What do you call that song?
It's called Easter Island Heads, and it's named after the statues that have been found on Easter Island that no one can really explain how they got there.
And nobody can explain this song, I suppose.
Yeah, I'll attempt to explain some things.
How about the right at the top? You do some interesting intervals up high in the neck.
Yeah, when I was working out this song, I wanted to do an intro that would feature some octaves and fifths, which are things that normally don't lay out all that well on a guitar. Yeah. This kind of a sound. So I figured out a way to do it using open strings, mm-hmm. where you can start with your E string open, like there, and that's the roll pattern that I used. Roll pattern with my flat pick and my middle finger. Mm-hmm. And I'm hitting the open E with my middle finger, and then I alternate back and forth between the flat pick and mm-hmm. the middle finger on the 12th fret, B and E strings. And so your hand can kind of stay there the whole time. Mm-hmm. Then I would drop the top note, and then drop the whole thing. So the chords you're getting are open E fifths, and then to kind of an E7, mm-hmm. and to an A. Mm-hmm. Then I moved into an E minor open string lick, which travels all the way down the strings. It sounds like this.
Kind of outlining the E minor chord, an E minor chord on the seventh fret.
Yeah, it's built on the E minor chord, and then I put the seventh in there in the fourth, so you get. So as you see, it's similar technique. Mm-hmm. It's still basically my middle finger and my pick going down across that. So that'll bring me back up to. And then,
so when you play it fast, it has a real nice ringy effect.
Yeah, it's kind of a harp-like effect. Right. And so that's, I kept the same roll pattern going, moving down to the B string, using that off of B chord.
So you had the root and fifth of B there, right?
Yeah, it's the same thing. B, F sharp, and B, mm-hmm. down to the seventh, and then a lower inversion of the E minor,
right? Yeah.
And then a suspended. Can keep your roll going, or make up any roll that you want with your right hand, and just kind of fool around and see what sounds good.
Other rolls, like maybe you can give some ideas for creating other, what you call them, finger rolls, right?
Yeah, when I say roll, it's usually a pattern between your flat pick and either one of these two fingers or both of them. And I think a lot of the technique comes from a five-string banjo, where it's called a three-finger style in the right hand. One real recognizable thing that you could use this kind of roll on is Monkees' 1966 hit Last Train to Clarksville, where the lick is so you're playing this melody with your flat pick,
right.
Then you add these two fingers on the G string and the B string. That's a good way to practice doing that kind of a roll.
Yeah, it's definitely has a banjo sound.
Yeah. There's another roll that you can do. It's this is really an exact banjo roll off of Foggy Mountain Breakdown. Earl Scruggs' roll that he starts that is, now he's got a different setup of strings where the high string is on the top, but modified for the guitar, it sounds like this. And that roll is You hammer on here on the fifth fret on your A string.
Mm-hmm.
Now you're using your flat pick again mm-hmm. on the A string and your middle finger on the open D.
Right.
So you have to do those two hammers. You speed that up. And you can move that around all over the place.
Yeah. Just takes practice to get that in sync. That's the probably the most important part in time.
The right hand roll is hard, and when you first start, these fingers are gonna feel like they're not attached to your brain. But after a while, you can train them. They'll do all right.
Do you like anchor your hand a certain way when you play that
stuff? Most of the time, yeah, I'll have my little finger or maybe, you know, parts of my hand either anchored on the bridge or on the pick guard.
It helps you to stay really locked in place with that type of technique.
Right? Yeah, and even for flat picking, I do that as well.
I think you even showed me a simpler exercise. You can just play an open chord and do that type of...
Yeah, the one I heard that roll on a Chet Atkins playing on an old Leuven Brothers record, mm-hmm. and he used it as an ending lick, and he just started at the bottom of the guitar and went all the way up.
So it's just playing C chord.
Playing a C chord, with the fifth in the bass.
Mm-hmm.
You know, just the add. Here's a standard C chord.
Right.
Added that in the bottom so you can, and that's flat pick, middle finger, ring finger,
mm-hmm.
and the same roll pattern, just move it up a string each time.
So fast that would sound like. Yeah, nice.
And that's the same kind of technique that I used in Highlander Boogie, which
is the Hellecasters.
Yeah, Return of the Hellecasters album. And I like that sound, so I kind of wrote a little song around it. You can hear it in.
That's great. So what are you doing there?
Well, the first part is you're off an A chord.
Right.
And you're doing a hammer on and a pull off. You hammer, you start on your A, second fret on the G string, start on A. You hammer on, two frets above,
mm-hmm.
pull it off again.
All right.
So. So all together.
Nice.
Sounds like that. Then we get into the roll.
Mm-hmm.
Which is, I'm hammering to a G chord.
Uh-huh. And using that same thing you showed Chet Atkins type thing.
Same roll, yeah. And then, same kind of thing on a D chord, except for I'm doing a hammer within the roll. So you can get the sound of you got the sound of your bass notes traveling up.
Right. With the answering roll. Yeah.
Right. So it's kind of a fun technique to do.
You can show it one more time in context.
Fat.
Sounds like two or three guys playing, actually.
Yeah.
Really effective. You know, in the tune you just played, Easter Island Heads,
mm-hmm. right?
Okay. When the tune starts to get faster, you do this real nice, using open strings again,
Yeah, it's a similar kind of a related technique. The actual melody of the song starts out with a couple of double string bends. You're starting from, which the song's in E minor again, and you're starting on the F sharp and a D on your seventh fret, and you're bending those up to a G and an E.
So that sounds like an E minor now.
Right. Nice and out of tune there. Here's one for the blue for real. And then, same thing.
Boy, that must be really hard to achieve. You're getting different length bends on each string, right?
Yeah, it is tough to get exactly in tune. Yeah. Yeah, it is tough. So, you got those bends that are starting the song. Then I do a little run up to one of these hammering slash open string roll licks.
Hammering slash.
Doing hammering.
Maybe show it fast first. And whatever. Wow, okay. You can break that apart.
So break that down. We got a scale running up into it. Then we got a hammer. Starting on your D string, hammer up, two whole steps, then play the A on your G string. So that's kind of outlining a D chord.
Yeah.
And then the back half of that lick is, now you're hammering a full D major chord. Right. Open D, F sharp on the fourth fret. A on the seventh fret,
right. Root third.
D fifth. On the G string, seventh fret. So you got. And then on the A string, it's the exact same pattern.
That's a new chord.
Right. Yeah. You just moved it down a string, starting on your A string. But you can do. It's kind of fun because. In this area of the guitar, you can do the same, finger the same lick, and move it across. And then I finish the lick with two of the open string rolls, starting here. You got your F sharp on the D string, followed by open B and D.
Nice little dissonance there.
Yeah, it almost gives you an E minor kind of a. E minor ninth kind of sound. Nine. And then you got the kind of the sixth against the seventh and the third.
But it goes by so fast, you know. It's easy to take, eh?
Yeah. So the whole lick.
That's great.
Idea.
Yeah, it sounds like has a tapping sound, you know, right hand tapping.
Which yeah.
Actually, you do some of that in that.
Yeah, a little bit in that song. I'm up in here to. And that's off of a C chord and a E minor chord. Starting on the third of the chord. Here on the B string, fifth fret, E. Playing it. Third, raised fourth, the fifth, and the root. Now, I can leave my left hand exactly the same, and I got the change to the E minor chord. I have the root, the second, and the third of the E minor chord, and I just move my right hand down one fret to have the fifth of the E minor chord here.
All right. So you're really thinking chords and chord tones more than scales.
Like, yeah. I figure I like the sound of tapping. You know, it gives you a whole different kind of thing and different intervals and things that you can't do otherwise.
Yeah.
But I do think of it more in a chordal way than. But it is still, there's scale tones build a chord.
Right.
Anyway,
right.
So.
But it is, you know, the way you explain it, you're obviously thinking, you know, what chord am I on now? And
yeah.
Outline the chord with the tones.
Another thing that I do sometimes for tapping is and that's out of the key of B.
Mm-hmm.
I'm kind of staying on one string, and you got my root is here, and the seventh is here.
So you're actually, that was a G string.
Yeah, I'm on the G string.
But it's in B, right?
Now that's outlining a B7 chord,
mm-hmm,
with your A, B, and D sharp
right
there. So I'm kind of. I'm moving my right hand finger just up the B scale. And it gives you all these different tonalities because you're always getting the root in the seventh down here.
So your left hand is really suggesting the chord,
right,
sound of the chord.
It's staying there. It's,
right,
yeah, it's giving you the root. Third, fourth, fifth, sixth, seventh, root.
You find that works a lot if you keep your hand anchored in root and seventh, root and flat sevens? And
depending on the tonality, you know, sometimes you can anchor it. Like on the first example, I anchored it starting on the third. You know, the third of a C chord.
Mm-hmm. Right, yeah.
And it anchored back to the root of the E chord.
Mm-hmm.
That seems to work for me, having a place for my left hand to kind of sit and hammer and then move my right hand around a little bit.
Yeah.
And it gives it a little bit different tonality than a lot of the tapping licks that you might hear that kind of move all the way across the strings.
Right, I think a different tone. That's another thing I notice you using your pickup selector quite a bit for different flavors.
So. Yeah, I do like to try to change colors as much as possible. Certain things will sound a lot cleaner on the back pickup, but if you want to get a big, robust, full lead sound, maybe the back pickup's, you know, is a little harsh.
Mm-hmm.
So, and then the middle I find is a good place for clean rhythm, open string things. I was using that, the middle position for this, another roll, example of another roll.
With the chorus type pedal. And
yeah.
Just because it rings more?
Yeah, it gives it kind of a nice swirl. And it's a little bit mellower than the back position and not quite as muddy as the front.
Right.
So it's nice for chordal passages. So that that lick right there is another example of a roll that you can do. It's another C to E minor move.
Mm-hmm.
It's just kind of a big move in this song. Now I've got my E string and my G string both ringing open. And those are common notes to both the C chord and the E minor chord. So on the top, I've got a G and a C,
mm-hmm,
which will give you C chord.
Mm, yeah. Mm-hmm.
And then once again, if I drop the C down, I'm back to an E minor.
Right. Look for chords that have, you can just change one note and have a different chord.
Yeah. Mm. It gives it, because one thing about a guitar that's unusual than other instruments is open strings. And so you might as well use that to your advantage.
Yeah.
You know, and plus open strings sound so good. Another section of Easter Island Heads, I do just let the top E string ring through all the time.
Yeah.
And then I move around a little melody on the lower strings like this.
it's like a real simple idea, devise it, really use effectively.
Yeah, you can just keep that E string going here with your, again, with your ring finger, and then play whatever you want, kind of a melody with your other, you know. I kind of stay mostly on the B string just because it's easy.
Yeah.
I grew up in the 60s listening to 60s music, and so there's a lot of things that use that open E string, and I was like the sound of it.
Yeah, that sitar influence they had in the late 60s for a while.
Yeah.
There you go. Play it, Brian.
Yeah.
There's also, I love how you end the song. I love the rhythm everybody's playing together, plus what you're playing, which is the octave idea.
Oh, the very ending of the song where we've kind of slowed down that lick, and when we get to the end.
Speaking of how you slowed it down, you did a real interesting turnaround. You were in one feel, one tempo, and
yeah,
what
it's
happened
technically
to you?
Called a metric modulation, mm-hmm. where you use an element of 1 meter to move into another meter. And what we did is this lick, if you play that over and over again, it's kind of a dotted eighth kind of a feel when you're playing it in the 4-4. If you play it over and over again, it kind of becomes another tempo. And you can use it like...
Each pattern becomes a then. Well.
Yeah, it becomes a... You can turn them around and kind of make them ones instead mm-hmm. of a dot.
Right.
That's kind of a fun thing to do.
Yeah, that was cool.
And you get to the very end, you were saying the octave thing. It's a rare thing that you hear, again, more than a couple of octaves on a guitar at the same time. So I wanted to hear the sound of the four octaves together. So I got my open E string, low E, and then E here on the 7th fret of the A string, another E here on the G string, 9th fret, and then the 12th fret on the high E string.
You have a new type of roll over there too.
Yeah, you can use...
pick twice.
Yeah, this is kind of a... I don't know, a combination, I guess, of a sweep and a roll. Yeah. You sweep across the first two strings. And then you pick the second two.
Yeah. Do you find yourself using that type?
Well, you know, that comes from a mandolin technique called cross-picking that Jesse McReynolds invented, and you can use that on the guitar too. It gives you kind of the same idea as you get with the roll that we were talking about before,
right.
But gives you the flat pick sound. Just and you get a down, down, up pattern with your flat pick.
Yes, harsher. Stronger sounding.
Yeah, you give a little bit more even, too.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah, that was nice. Town Without Pity.
Gene Pitney had a hit on it in the early 60s. And it's a melody that's built on minor ninths. And I kind of like minor ninth chords anyway. And so I used that kind of all through the song. In fact, the beginning of it, I used a bending technique that's most often used in country, you know, straight country things, like licks like this.
Which is what?
Yeah. We're bending up we're playing a C chord, basically. Mm-hmm. The fifth, the root, mm-hmm. and the second. And then you take your second and you bend it up a whole step.
Ouch. Yeah, it's nice.
Yeah, don't do this with heavy strings. So I use that same idea in the minor kind of sense. Song starting out in C minor, take the third and the root, so you're getting this.
Yeah. So where are you here?
This is would be an F minor chord.
Okay.
Then I move up to an A flat 7 and pull the root up to make it a 9.
Yeah.
Then I go to an augmented chord and move it down in whole tones. Yeah, using your roll. This time, you're starting with the ring finger.
Oh, it's a little bit backwards.
Yeah, it's a backwards roll. Start the ring finger, and then your flat pick, and your middle finger. Move down.
Nice.
And it gives kind of that augmented.
Yeah.
Kind of scary spy music kind of.
Where is it going?
Yeah.
Where are we going to end? That bend, yeah, the bend idea, most heard in country, you know.
Yeah, when you're emulating music. A pedal steel, you know, it would be that kind of a.
But you don't have to be, you know, and be playing a country song or a country.
Yeah,
song.
You can use it in a lot of different ways. There's a place to use it.
What's that happening there?
Kind of going from a A minor to a G.
Mm-hmm.
Taking your A minor and bending the third up a whole step.
Right. So sus.
Now sus. You could also, that could be a D. D7.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know, there's a lot of different ways you can use that. You can also do it. If you're, say, here's a C minor, and you can do only a half step bend.
Yeah.
It's a little bit easier on your fingers, too.
Right, so what gauge strings are these?
These are a 10 gauge, and I would recommend either 10s or a 9 set for this kind of thing.
Yeah.
You know, because any heavier than that, and it gets pretty painful. There's a lot of places that you can do that same idea. Here's kind of a jazzy sounding one.
All right, so you're playing.
You're taking your root, third, seventh, and a flat 9.
To a sharp 9, huh?
Yeah.
Yeah. Wow.
You can use it as a 5-1 cadence in the key of A.
Yeah. Who'd have thought these country ideas?
Yeah, there's a lot of, or you can do this kind of. That's also taking you're starting on a E7th chord. Third here on the 11th fret.
Mm-hmm.
Seventh here on the 12th fret. And your root on the 9th. And bending that root up to a 9th again.
Yeah.
You can also take a whole chord and bend it. That's kind of a nice thing to do. I did that, I think, somewhere in town with that pity too. I was up here. And it gives you almost a Hawaiian kind of
effect. Yeah, I was going to say, it's like a steel guitar or whatever.
Or a horn section is kind of going crazy. So don't be afraid of just bending anywhere.
Yeah, you can even kind of just shake a chord sometimes. Just
yeah, give it that.
All right, it's a nice sound. You started the Town Without Pity, mainly like a single note melody. Then you started adding, you know, like a chord melody type thing to the melody. That was nice.
Well, in a trio format, you kind of are required, I think, to do more chords and at least try to imply the chords. If it's a more complex chord than maybe a standard major or minor, you know, and you've got your melody note, the bass has got the bass note, mm-hmm. you kind of need to fill in some of the other notes.
It doesn't have to be an entire chord either.
No, you can just play parts of it. Like you say, I started the song off with just the melody single note mm-hmm. up here in C minor.
Using nice bends, I might add, too.
Oh, thanks. Yeah, I started here on the ninth, bending up to the minor third. And then I bent the root up to the ninth. So you can take something that's pretty simple. Right. There's the melody. Mm-hmm. That doesn't sound that interesting, but if you put those bends in it.
Yeah, a little bluesy sound.
Yeah, it'll make it fit more to the guitar.
Just breathes life into it too.
Yeah, it helps you kind of put your own personality into the melody as well. And then the second, you can move that down and kind of do the same thing. So you get the downward bend as well.
Yeah. You've already bent the note to its pitch, right? And then
right.
attack it. Nice effect.
Then you were talking about the chords.
You're actually just playing a few notes of the chord. You know.
Yeah, not the full chord. I get the melody in the top. Melody in the top.
Yeah. So the first one you played.
Yeah. This move is from a D flat sixth chord. Mm-hmm. To a C7. This is nice because only these two notes move. Mm-hmm.
And you get a note on top.
Yeah, with the melody note being staying there.
Yeah.
Gives you a complete different tonality. And then it moves to an F minor to an A flat. Mm-hmm. So the idea is figure out where you really need to hear those chords, give you the tonality, and then just pop them in there. So you don't need to do every chord, you know, of the melody. You certainly can, but it kind of makes it interesting to break it up between single notes and chords.
You were also moving some chords around, like in a chromatic scale almost, some certain sections. Like a dominant nine chord shape or something.
Yeah, it's a shape of a ninth chord, but I was using it to function as a minor sixth. Hmm. Like if this would be your standard ninth chord.
G9.
But if you leave out that G and then imply the root is down here on D, it becomes a D minor sixth. And the song modulated from C minor up to D minor.
Uh-huh.
So I'm using it as a D minor sixth. I took the melody up, D to the E, the nine.
That melody again being.
It's kind of a new melody, actually. Oh, okay. It isn't the melody of the song. Yeah, so just a little part. Take this top string up a whole step to the ninth, and then another half step to the minor third, and then back down to the major seventh. So this is a really bizarre chord, because you have the major seventh and the sixth with a minor third and a fifth at the same time. That is a great sounding chord.
And the bass player is still on D.
Yeah, with your D. And then you can move the whole chord. The next part of the song is off of a G minor chord. So I move this whole chord.
Right.
And made the same move, the identical same move on that chord.
Yeah, could you show it how that fit in the song?
Yeah.
In a second.
Fit a couple of jazzy chords, and also shows how you can a shape of a chord can function in many different ways depending on what's in the bass.
That's right. Could you give another example of one?
Sure. You can take a diminished chord, maybe you'd play in your top four strings. You could call this an F diminished or an A flat diminished, or a B diminished, or a D diminished, depending on whatever root you got. Mm-hmm. Now, if you put a G in the base of that chord, it changes it into a G7 with a flat 9.
There you go.
You got your root, 7, 3rd, 5th, and flat 9. Another thing is, if you do a diminished chord down here,
six string root there.
Like say, here you got a A diminished. Well, you can also think of that as an A minor sixth. This is your root, this is your third, and your sixth. So you can experiment around and try moving your bass note on a chord that you've already got and see how it changes it.
cool song, but what a guitar.
This was done by, the artwork was done by a guy who used to work at Gibson named Greg Rich. And he's an old friend of mine that used to live in Costa Mesa. Moved to Nashville, they made him the head of the banjo department there because he knew how to do all this artwork that they used to do on their banjos, or fancy banjos in the 20s and 30s. And he did some things like this in his spare time for fun, and they got so much attention at their NAMM shows and things like that that they said, okay, this is your job. And I had always wanted an Epiphone Casino because the Beatles played them a lot, a big Beatles fan. And so I asked him, would you make me a guitar, you know, with a theme of the Beatles on there and kind of pattern it after an Epiphone Casino. Mm-hmm. And so he decided to take the artwork from Yellow Submarine and make the guitar yellow, and I think he just did a killer job on it.
That's amazing.
He handmade all this binding, red, yellow, green, and black sparkle, swirly binding. And it's also just a great sounding guitar too. It's got P90s and a wraparound tailpiece, which you don't usually see on this, you know, combination on this kind of body.
And the body is actually hollow?
It's semi-hollow. There's a block of wood through the center, just like a 335. Mm. So you don't get as much feedback, and you get a little more sustain.
Yeah. Talk about tone. I mean, you know, your tone is impeccable. What kind of amps are you? You always use the matchless?
Yeah, I played Vox AC30s for years, actually about 10 years. Mm. And they're a great sounding amp, but they're, most of them are old, and they're very fragile. And so I kept asking Mark Sampson, well, it would be nice to have an amp that sounded this good, but held together a little better, you know, made more roadworthy. Mm-hmm. And so that was the design that he took for this matchless amp here. It's patterned after a Vox AC30, Class A 30-watt tube amplifier.
Right.
But just built a little bit heftier and with a little more features, you know, that they didn't have back then, master volume and high-low power switch, so you can have the sound of a 15-watt amp, you know, working really hard.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I noticed you use your pedals for more for the gain, the high gain.
Yeah, for distortion, usually I go in the front, mainly because I have reverb before I go into the amp as well. Mm-hmm. So if you use a lot of gain and distortion from your amp, reverb's not going to sound too good.
Yeah, it really gets boosted somehow.
Yeah, it compresses and makes it sound odd. So I usually use tube screamers before, you know, tube screamers, and then maybe a digital delay pedal, Boss Dimension C I like to use for a chorus type pedal, and I also like their digital reverb pedal. And then I send that to fairly clean sound in the matchless. Maybe a little bit, pushing it just a little bit. But then I can use the tube screamers to kick in at whatever amount of distortion that I want to use.
So if you're up full on your guitar in a clean setting, you just have a little bit of grit, say, on the amp?
It'll push it just a little bit. And if I really slam chords and stuff, it'll break up just a hair.
Yeah, that seems to be a mistake a lot of guitar players make, is too much saturation on the amp and you don't get dynamics and
the thing is, you lose punch, you know. I mean, a lot of times, I mean, distortion's great and you want it to be distorted, but what makes distortion to me sound more aggressive is that you're pushing something to the point where it just can barely take it. Well, if you've pushed it all the way over the other side and it's completely saturated, it's almost laying down and going to sleep, you know.
Yeah,
it needs to be really pushed. And I think Pete Townsend was one of the guys that had probably the best combination of a clean but really powerful distortion sound.
Getting into the song, what was the title of that?
It's called The Anti-Knock Jump.
The Anti-Knock Jump.
Titled because it was written while I was playing in Tokyo last year at a Japanese New York style club called Anti-Knock. Who knows?
You're using like a Travis picking type?
Yeah, rockabilly kind of Travis picking thing in the B sections. And And you can move that all over the neck.
So actually, what is happening on your right hand there?
Oh, okay. You're kind of doing an eighth note pattern with your pick.
Almost that a root kind fifth of a, type thing.
Yeah.
Sort of.
Like if you were in E, say you were on an E7.
Mm-hmm.
It's kind of the. You're playing your A string, then your D string, then your open E string, and back to the D, back alternating that.
Same. And then counterpoint with your.
Yeah, and then on this hit. And then after that, you hit that one. So you can do that same pattern anywhere.
And then maybe you cheat a little bit once in a while if you have a chord that isn't set up so good for that.
Yeah, you don't. The notes on the bottom are not as important as just keeping that rhythm going. Yeah, sometimes you can just alternate like that.
Is it harder on a six string root chord, like maybe a bar?
Oh, if you're here?
Yeah. Yeah, you actually do the same.
You can kind of do it all over, you know, if you want to spread your hand out so you're getting the top strings and the bottom strings, or if you want to keep it in the center a little bit. It's a fun technique to fool around with.
Yeah. Could you play a little bit of that part of the song?
Yeah. So if we're starting. The intro of the song is some kind of scale type of things.
Yeah, that was the first thing when you're doing almost that banjo type thing again.
Kind of, yeah. We're kind of fooling around down the first three frets, almost bluegrass style.
So you are spending a lot of time just on one note.
Yeah, starting here on the high E string on the G note. You kind of move a scale down from there. And I'm keeping my picking hand going in an alternating form most all the time. Getting a few little pull-offs.
And again, lots of open strings.
Yes. Yeah. Little hammer there.
And letting them ring when you're on, when you finish off the lick, but there's still some ringing. Nice effect.
There's another lick that I use in that song. It's a technique, really, that I learned from Django Reinhardt Records. Mm. And Django is probably my idol.
And, good idol to have.
Yeah, I think the greatest guitar player ever. Because he did so much that no one had ever done before. You know, no one had really played that kind of single string jazz melodies and with the kind of technique that he had. And put that with the fact that he only had two fingers on this hand to use. Mm. It's pretty incredible. But anyway, this lick, it's another kind of a pick roll pattern. Where you play a downstroke here. That's the pattern. Down, up, down.
So you're actually playing the same pattern, just moving the.
Yeah, you're left moving it all around. You're actually always going back and forth on this, on your right hand. And so your first pattern will be down, up, down, then up, down, up. It'll alternate back and forth between down, up, down, up.
Yeah.
So when you keep it going, you're always alternating. and you can move that around anywhere. You can do it on the E string. And use it on an E chord. You can start.
That's more diatonic, like two thirds.
Yeah, you're kind of moving down. You put that with this kind of picking pattern, and you get that.
Yeah, nice. And then you're not afraid to use those chromatic ideas, have an idea going and moving it up dramatically.
It's take it all over the place.
Effective.
Otherwise, I think in that song I used a little bit of double string bends.
So what's happening there?
So you're taking a G and a B here on the 12th fret, mm-hmm. moving it up to a C and an A. And then you can bend that a full step or a half step. If you want it kind of bluesy sounding, do the half step. If you want it more majory, do the full.
Again, and then one string is actually being bent a whole step and one is a half, or?
They're both being, on that one, they're both being bent a whole step.
Take some practice.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So otherwise, there's a couple other bluegrass licks in there too. This one, that's really a Clarence White / Tony Rice lick. It's part of a G run, mm-hmm. which in bluegrass is this, which you'll hear a lot. In bluegrass songs, at the end of every phrase, the guitar player will always do that. So if you put a little spin on it, you're pulling off, actually, and then hammering up.
Sort of like a minor and a major idea put together.
Right. Yeah. You get the blues kind of sound by having this minor third pulled off. Then.
Yeah.
Major third. And you can sit on that too. And it'll turn around the beat a little bit.
That's something I've noticed in your playing. You do a lot of, like, a little bit of a major lick, and then a little bit of the same type lick, minor, and then major, minor.
Well, you know, that can take you in between the one chord and the four chord. If you're doing that, say, if we're in the key of G, you're here on a G chord. Maybe you wanted to. You're getting like a G sixth kind of
yeah,
a lick.
The E makes.
Now, if you take it to G minor, but it'll function as a four chord.
Oh, yeah.
Because what you're you got your third, your root, and your fifth. Now, if you do that in here. On a C chord, this is your seventh, fifth, and ninth.
Yeah.
And you get a nice cluster here when you have the open E. And you can do that down here, the same kind of thing.
Yeah.
Going from the G.
All right, real nice. And you can even do that even if the band is staying on the G, just to
right. You can
make it a minor sound.
Clash it against it to get a more blues sound, or you know the third really gives you your color to any chord, and that's the thing that's going to either make it sound sweet and pretty or kind of mean and bluesy.
Mm-hmm.
If you want a meaner sound, go with the minor third. And if you want kind of an ambiguous sound, go in between.
Yeah.
And it's funkier. You know, John Lennon had a way of singing a third that was not quite minor and not quite major, and it really sounded great. It gave a real nice edge to it. So, thank you, John.
Yes, and thank you, John, for coming down here and playing your wonderful style for us today.
Oh, my pleasure. I hope everybody out there enjoys the tape and learns a few new licks.